Water in a glass might look clear and colourless, but you may have noticed that despite being made up of cool, clear, and colourless water, it's rather difficult to see the bottom of the ocean. So, what is the colour of water, and what lies below? From the surface, we see that the ocean blue looks, well, blue. A large part of why the ocean is that colour, however, has little to do with the water. The surface of the water reflects the light hitting it, and so shows the colour of the sky. However, while this reflection contributes to the observed colour, it is not the sole reason. To understand more, we have to dive a bit deeper and see what lies beneath. Just below the surface, we find some light has been reflected, but most has penetrated the water surface and is interacting with the molecules. Impurities in the water will be making a large difference to the observed colour. Dissolved lime in some lakes gives the water a turquoise colour, while the surface waters of the ocean are teeming with photosynthetic phytoplankton, busily capturing the available light energy and conferring a greenish hue. But as we dive deeper below the surface of the ocean, we find light doesn't penetrate this much water particularly well. Shorter wavelengths penetrate a bit further than longer ones. The water has absorbed the longer wavelengths of red, orange, yellow, and green light, and left us seeing only the faint blue hue of the scattered blue light. And we can see our answer. The colour of water is blue. How blue? Only just, but by about 200 meters, there is so little light, photosynthesis cannot occur. So photosynthetic life cannot exist past this point. But deep at the bottom of the ocean, life exists around thermal vents. Since light doesn't penetrate this far down, this life can't rely on photosynthesis for energy. So for organisms down here, photosynthesis gives way to chemosynthesis. The ecosystem turns to bacteria that oxidize hydrogen sulfide being produced from the vents as their energy source, using dissolved oxygen in the water as the electron acceptor. However, the need for this dissolved oxygen provides a link back to the photosynthetic phytoplankton on the surface. The tube worms might not be reliant on them for energy, but they do need their byproduct to make their own reactions possible. How does the tube worm extract the oxygen from the water? The answer is using a similar protein to how humans transport oxygen around our own bodies, hemoglobin. The presence of this blood is why the chitin bodies of the worms are topped with red plumes, an organ for exchanging compounds with its environment. But this is no usual hemoglobin. These are weird massive chains of hemoglobin, up to 144 globin chains long. Compare this with the 4 in human blood cells. Why does it need a weird hemoglobin? Most hemoglobins are inhibited by sulfur, which is a common element when you're sitting next to a geothermal vent. But the worms need the oxygen, and so invest in these chains. So despite the blue-coloured water preventing the light from reaching this deep, life finds a way to survive by using the waste products of those in the water above.